Welcome to the STABcast, a podcast dedicated to Star Wars Legion.
Welcome, cadets and commanders, to episode 1 of the STABcast, a Star Wars Legion podcast. I'm your T-47 pilot, Ben Fowler, joined by tail gunner Ryan Slawoski and Imperial AT-ST insurance investigator, Will Heim. Gentlemen, how are y'all doing tonight?
I'm doing fantastic.
Doing great.
Excellent, excellent.
My neck is just so heavy from all these medals. All the medals.
Oh, here we go.
Yep, gots to. So this week at the top of the STABcast, we are proud to bring you episode 1. In this episode, we are going to be bringing you some news and battle reports from our awesome weekend at Adepticon at the fully armed and operational launch event. We're going to be talking about how to design a battlefield. And we're going to talk about our favorite 500-point armies that you can play at your launch parties, at your kickoff events, whatever you happen to be calling them. And we've also got a few other surprises tucked away in this episode.
So first with our news, congratulations, we've now officially launched. Woo!
Yay!
So welcome. I hope you've been gluing things together, mostly your hands to the table, putting together models, finding that all your Vaders have enough arms to welcome him. So welcome to the hobby. Welcome to the game board. Welcome to the table. Hope you've been painting for a little bit. Personally, I have not been painting.
I've done absolutely zero painting. Yeah, no painting happened.
Nothing. So we spent the launch of the game at a convention in Chicago called Adepticon, and they ran a really cool launch event that took us through assembling models for a while and then 500-point battles on Thursday for the release of the game. And we do want to give a shout out to Hank Edley, who organized the whole event, and especially, I'm going to mess up your name, Mitchka Bailey, who let us use his actually painted armies for the event.
Yeah, they were really cool. I got to rock some really rad-looking rebs. Being the only painted squad on the table made me feel a little special.
If you checked out our Instagram feed during Adepticon, I took many, many pictures, both of the artist and his models. They were quite beautiful.
They really were.
Yeah, they were super rad.
So at this event, I was using my glorious Imperials and decided to try to use an AT-ST in the 500-point format. It was Darth Vader with Force Choke and Saber Throw, two naked Stormtrooper squads, and a naked AT-ST. That's all I could fit into the list. It was not very good.
It looked beautiful sitting on that table.
Yeah, it did look really cool.
It commanded the battlefield.
The AT-ST on a 3x3 is imposing as all get out.
Especially the tables you were playing on, because did you play all your maps on the indoor setting?
I did, yes.
That's cool. That's kind of cool.
The AT-ST emerging between two trees is just, I like to think I struck some fear into the hearts of my enemies.
Yeah, but did you strike objective points into them?
No. No, I did not.
Oh, okay.
I played on the same mat all day against 3 Rebel players. I ended up 1-2, and most of that was because my objective claiming ability was terrible. When you need unit leaders to claim objectives, then you have 3 of them, and your opponent has 4, and his are surrounded by way more ablative bodies, it doesn't go well. Shout out to my round 2 opponent, who really wanted me to say that he beat me very, very badly.
I think I was next to you that game. It was pretty rough. So I took some Rebels. You know, you guys heard me talk about, if you listened to episode 0, about the glory and the gospel of the AT-RT. So I noticed a lot of players, Rebel players, were taking 1 AT-RT and 3 groups of troopers, and then Luke. And I decided to up the ante by only taking 2 groups of troopers, but I had 2 AT-RTs. So I had Luke Skywalker with Mind Trick and Force Reflex, whose job was to pretty much just move and or attack and then refresh and use his abilities. I had 2 groups of troopers, both of them having the extra body, and then each of them having a different heavy weapon upgrade, whether it's the Z7 like minigun or the ion gun, to deal with whatever threats I had happen to come my way. And then I had 2 AT-RTs with flamers that did the Lord's work and spit some holy fire, taking me to 3-0 on the day. But I did not get the top spot. I missed it by 1 objective point. And it was a bit of a heartbreak, but it was still a lot of fun to go throw all the black dice on all the trooper brigades. And not a lot of players had access to the impact keyword, other than I played a really scary Imperialist with double bikes that I just barely managed to beat. It was really, really scary. I feel like a terrible person because I was so excited to play the game. I didn't write down a lot of my opponent's names. They were all wonderful, kind, interesting people. So I apologize. Post on our Facebook, Instagram, or whatever. Tell me I'm dumb and remind me of your name. I played some really interesting Imperialists from double bikes. I didn't see any AT-STs. to some weird different amalgamations of troopers to really help put the pressure on. I did play round one, my friend Chase from Nashville. So we had a little cross Tennessee battle in round one that ended in a really cool fashion. We had this weird map with this super tall cover kind of splitting it in two, making it look like a bit like an H. We had a group of troopers versus an AT-RT on the right, and then an AT-RT and a group of troopers and Luke versus Vader and two groups of troopers on the left. And Vader and Luke ran into melee with each other, started swinging away while the troopers just peppered each other with suppression tokens from light cover. And it came down to a command card flip for initiative when Vader and Luke were both on one hit point. And I got the edge to activate Luke first. Luke strikes Vader down. And then all of his troopers, now that they no longer have unlimited bravery, just fled the battlefield. The sad thing was, is the game ended so quickly. Our objective was to get units into each other's deployment zones. And my units were too far back to really get up there, meaning I only got one objective point for the first map. Round two, I played on this really cool, like, TIE Defender factory map where we had to sit close to different pieces of terrain. And at the end of the game, whoever had the most unit leaders adjacent to terrain managed to score points. And this is where I played this really weird double bike list that really was kind of frustrating, the way it could sloop around the terrain and put pressure on my flanks. I got to teach my opponent kind of an important lesson that AT-RTs can back up, because the real big decider for the game was he came and did a really good job flanking my AT-RTs with his bikes that could generate impact. And he forgot that I could just back up and turn. And it caused me to get a really good attack with my flamers that ignore the bike's cover and pick them off, winning that map 2-1. Round three, I felt bad, man. Like, he had a good list. We had pretty even lists. He had an extra trooper brigade than I did because I had the extra AT-RTs. And the mission was to have our troopers run out, grab these objective tokens, and then at the end of the round, whoever has them and survives wins. It was on the same TIE Defender factory map, which had these kind of high walls with doors in them. And my dice just went hot. At one point, I think my Z7 threw four of its six dice as hits onto a trooper squad that had an objective, and it was just a crazy game. He did a really good job of using Vader to tie up my units. He then managed to get Luke down to one, thinking that he was safe going into the last round, but then what he kind of forgot was the AT-RTs have really great melee attacks, and I managed to just be able to get my AT-RT within base-to-base contact with Vader, and then I kicked Darth Vader to death. It was very sad. It was a close game. It would have been a close game, but the dice were just all my way. So I got to give my opponents credit. All three of my opponents in the solo event were really cool, really rad people, and we had a lot of fun asking all these kind of ridiculous questions as we all learned the game. And then on Saturday, I got to play with Chase, my round one opponent from Nashville. We decided to team up for the team event. He's an Imperial player, but I said, you know what? I bought the team ticket. We're going to play Rebels, dang it. So we built some Rebel armies. And the format was basically 900 points, and then we were given a second commander to play with. And I actually got to play, if you've been watching our Twitter feed, I got to play with Leia. She was a lot of fun. She had no upgrades and only one of her command cards, but we got to play about a 1,000-point game on the big 6x3 mats, and we had an incredible time. We went 3-0. We got best overall squad. We had a really good time and played some really cool, cool people and some really, like, man, every one of these games was super tight. I want to give a shout out to Team Spaceballs, my second round opponent. They were awesome guys. Probably my favorite game between X-Wing and Legion of the convention that came down to literally the last activation to see who was going to win or not. They were a lot of fun to play with. The dice were crazy both directions. There was an AT-ST that blocked, I think, like 7 damage in a row from my double heavy laser cannon AT-RTs that were firing at it. But then I shot a Z7 at Vader without a dodge token, and he just kind of died. It was very sad. Like, the dice were super all over the place, back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. And it came down to having to claim terrain pieces. And on the last activation, one of our rebel squad leaders that was in a squad of just the squad leader, like, you poke him and he dies, managed to double move, touch a piece of terrain, and score us the 2-1 victory. And the team event was super, super, super fun. We're going to talk, I think, on a later show about the team format and why you should play it and how you should approach it. Three super, super cool, super long team games. We probably played for like 9 hours straight, and it was an absolute, absolute ton of fun. Ben, how'd you do?
So Will and Ryan, you know, ingratiated themselves very quickly with the painter. They came up with beautiful armies, and there weren't a whole lot of left. The Adepticon staff was running the event, and they said they would have things for us to borrow. And I started to worry. And then right at 10 o'clock, FFG's organized play staff comes out and six of them start pulling boxes and pulling lists together. So I decided I was going to use the pre-built FFG list, which isn't a bad list for the 500-point team. So it had Luke Skywalker, it had Jedi Mind Tricks, it had two sets of troopers that had the Z6 trooper and extra troopers and targeting scopes, and then a third set that had the MPL 57 Ion Trooper and extra trooper and targeting scopes, and a single AT-RT with long-range comlink and flamethrowers. The only real downside in that list is you didn't need the long-range comlink. On a 3x3 map, Luke can see just about everyone from everywhere on that map, unless for some reason your AT-RT went sprinting. So that's 10 points I could have probably spent on force reflexes or something else like that. But overall, the list worked really well. I lost my first game to the double bike list. I'd only played one or two demo games. I'd watched a couple games and never actually really played a whole lot of it. I was still kind of learning my way around. What was I doing? He got the drop on me a couple of times. You know, I had some bad dice once or twice. You throw six against Vader. I threw five blanks and a hit.
That's rough.
That happens. You know, dice are dice. I won the next two games. I played on the same Imperial TIE manufacturing map that Ryan did for my second and my third games. Second one was against a Rebel player who brought out the Airspeeder, which, like the AT-ST, is a lot of fun. It looks really nice on the map. Doesn't do a whole lot of damage because it costs so many points at 500 lists. I won that game pretty handily and then had a fantastic fight over objective tokens. My opponent realized what we were going for because at that point, I think we discovered that Legion is not a game of murder ball. It's a game of getting things done.
Yeah, we'll get to that here in a minute.
And he decided, I'm going to get some things done. He managed to run out his troopers. He used the Vader command card, which gave them an extra action by offing one of his troopers, grabbed those command tokens, and then ran for cover. So I spent most of my game trying to track him down, murder him legitimately, and then take his tokens from him. So he withheld from me some victory tokens at the very end because I just didn't have the activations to get to them before the final round. It was a fantastic list. I really enjoyed it. And modifications of it are basically going to be the thing I recommend at the end of the show. I really enjoyed what FFG did. Just a couple of tweaks, I think, make that list really good for a 500-point event.
So if you missed any of our cool Adepticon coverage, you need to follow us on Facebook and Twitter and Instagram. And to help encourage you guys to do that, we managed to snag an extra Han Solo alt art card from Adepticon, and we're going to be giving that away between now and our next episode. So between whenever this episode drops till we record our next episode, if you share a link to this episode with the hashtag STABcast, either if you retweet it or if you share it on Facebook with a link to this episode, we're going to randomly pick one person who did that and mail them a copy of the alt art Han Solo. We're really excited. It looks like a super cool card. You won't be able to use it for a while, but you can totally show it off to your friends and help get the word out on our cool show. The other thing I want to promo is there's a tabletop simulator Legion tournament called the Invader League. They have a Discord chat up. You can check out our Twitter for a link to signups. The signups have a link to all the info you're going to need. There's some really rad prize support from some Wave 1 unit expansions to some Miniature Mart gift cards. And it's sponsored, I believe, by Imperial Terrain, who had a really sweet booth at Adepticon, and we got to play on a lot of their stuff on our tables. Right now, though, the league is full. But they're still taking applications for basically backup spots. So if people have to drop or can't make it, they're going to pull from that list and integrate people into the tournament. I have no idea how to play a tabletop simulator, but by the time signups are over, by God, I'm going to know. It's a full 800-point battle on pre-made tables. It looks super, super fun. Check out our Twitter for more information. And while you're there, give us a follow at STABcast. Twitter is probably the easiest way for us to get small doses of information out to you guys and to grab opinions and thoughts. And if you want to suggest like a future episode topic or some talking points or pick our brains on something, that's probably the best place to do it. So check us out at Twitter at STABcast. Be sure to also check out our Facebook page, Facebook at STABcast. We have probably the best discussion out of all of our social media formats there. Come join the discussion and chat it up with us. And you can also follow us at Instagram at STABcast. As we go around the next couple of weeks to tournaments and get to see some awesome painted models, we're going to be sharing all kinds of photos. I'm going to try to, at our next weekend events, put a photo of every turn up as we get to play. And the Instagram is the place to see all of that.
Yeah, I burned up the battery on, I think, Thursday. I took all the photos I possibly could of just about everything, and I posted them out there to you all. So,
all right. So One of the main benefits of getting to have our first few games at Adepticon was that the designer of the game, Alex Davey, was actually kind of walking around and was open to answering questions about anything that sort of came up. So we all kind of wanted to share some stuff that we weren't clear on going into the game and really had clarified thanks to him and just the experience of getting to play three tournament matches. So for me, one of the things that I wasn't clear on was the difference between measuring line of sight and measuring range. Because when you're measuring range, you have to do commander to commander. So from your stormtrooper commander to their rebel commander. But for line of sight and cover, it is using the goons. So if you're shooting at a squad with only one guy visible outside of like line of sight blocking terrain, and you deal like four wounds, only the guy that you can see will be removed from the table. The others are not reachable by the weapons because they're behind that large terrain feature. So getting that clarified was very helpful, and I'm not sure if there's ways you can really take advantage of that, but I do think it makes sense in the game format.
No, there's actually totally ways that you can take advantage of that. In my third game of the team match, we had a group of guys that tried to hide all of their units, save their rocket launcher guy, to take a pot shot at our AT-RT. But what they unfortunately forgot was the missile launcher has the cumbersome rule to where if he moves, he can't also shoot.
Mm-hmm.
And so what ended up happening is they had this squad within total concealment, and one of my rebel troopers had line of sight to only the missile launcher guy, which meant the whole squad rolled up and hit him for like five hits, and he got all five saves. He got to roll all five saves. He missed a couple of them, but he only had to take one casualty, but sadly it had to be the missile launcher guy.
Yeah.
See, I kind of did something in the same line. I ran half my squad around the side, including my minigun Z6. And so when it came to light something up, I was throwing lots of dice because I only needed one hit. There was just one unit back there, but he had to die because he had an objective token. So I threw him and two bodies in case I took some damage in return fire, which just mowed him down while keeping the rest of the force safe behind the other side of the wall. It worked really well.
And also, just to clarify one thing Will said, when measuring range, you don't have to measure commander to commander. You just have to measure your commander to their closest unit for distance. Yeah, just one little clarifying point.
Oh, okay.
But your distance is determined by your commander, not your most forward unit.
So something that you don't play in the demo game, but comes up when you play your first 500-point game, is suppression. And suppression is really good. Just firing at an opponent, as long as you get a single hit, the idea is that you got close enough that they had to dodge it, then the unit receives a suppression token. And that suppression token limits their actions. If they have a single suppression token, they lose an action. They could have one, two, or three suppression tokens, they lose that action. And so if you can shoot at something two or three times, you can make it to a place where it's very difficult for them to do anything other than to dodge or just shoot, but then have no dice modifications. Suppression can cause units to flee. Like Ryan said earlier in the show, if you kill off a commander who's helping support them, then suddenly they have lots of suppression. They're going to panic and they're going to run. So suppression is a very, very powerful thing. One of the Vader command cards just hands out suppression.
It's gross.
It is very gross. And next thing I know, a unit was running away because my Luke was a little too far away. I got lucky with some rally, took an action to kind of refresh myself, but I was headed towards the board edge if I didn't have any other ability to get around it. So if you haven't played with suppression yet, you're just kind of taking some things out of the box, try it. Look at those rules because they changed the game for me.
And one thing also came up was I didn't know that when you rally, you rolled a white die for each suppression token.
Right.
I thought it was just one. So in my mind, it actually sounded more terrifying, like, oh, I can only remove one. But I did have an opponent that had three suppression on a squad, roll three blocks and just be like, oh, we're fine now.
Yeah, I got to do that in my hot dice game. It was pretty cool for me and pretty sad for my opponent. But the other neat thing to note about suppression isn't always a bad thing. If you can get your dudes into the position they need to be in, preferably in light cover, and you can get suppressed down, like suppression increases your cover value because you're ducking and you're hiding. And so you do get a small benefit for trading off an action. And I got to use with my rebels that suppression to a big extent to just being able to take some positions that I otherwise couldn't take and stay alive a bit longer. And that's one thing to note about Vader. Vader has the dash bravery, so he is completely immune to all suppression, but that also means he doesn't get the free cover increase, making Vader a little bit easier to tackle.
Vader doesn't duck into cover?
No, he doesn't. Speaking of not ducking into cover when you probably should, the biggest and by far the biggest takeaway I had from my six Adepticon games was objective victory. you know, I'm an old X-Wing player where we only count points on what you kill, what you blow up, what you destroy. And this game is a game about objectives. It's not just about, you know, murder ball where you run in, throw a bunch of dice and pull models off the table, which is a lot of fun. And honestly, that mindset cost me the top spot in the singles event. And me and Chase's whole strategy in the doubles event was I would make tactical plans to murder everything. And then he would whisper in my ear, hey, does this score us points? And I'd be like, no, but scoring points doesn't let me remove his models. And I'd be sad, but we ended up doing the objective proper play. So when you're thinking of your strategies, when you're thinking of your moves in this game, be sure to think about objective victory over the kill game. For me, getting out of that X-Wing mindset and looking for the win and not the kill, because those aren't the same things anymore. The other thing you always need to manage is keep your eye on the clock. None of our games, none of my six games that I got to play ever went the distance to round six. A lot of that was because we were asking questions, we were learning the game, not everybody was super fast yet, which was fine, but we had to keep an eye on the clock. And there were a couple games that if I didn't push the game to start the next round, I would have lost. Or if the game would have gone an extra turn, I probably would have lost. So being able to manage the clock, so make your moves when you have the objective advantage, and trying to time that game end is huge. And when you're making a move, when you're planning an activation, you need to ask yourself three questions. The first question is, will this score me points? If the answer is no, you might want to look for a decision or an answer or a move that can move you into those points. The second thing you need to ask, will this move deny or pressure my opponent's points? If you can't find a yes for the first question, go with the second question. Look for a way to deny and stop them from scoring points. The third thing you need to ask yourself, if you can't find an answer for either of those things, will this move set me up to do one of the next two things next turn if there's going to be a next turn? Now, that third question is pretty much everything you do on the first turn of the game where you're just getting set up, you're moving into position. You know, usually there's not a whole lot of shooting. I want to say in my first game against Chase of the solo event, I had to go first, sadly, and so I had to move a bunch of my units up into range. And the funny thing that happened was I put Luke up there first, and I didn't get to roll a single set of attack dice in the first exchange, but Luke had a dodge token and got to reflect some damage back on stormtroopers to where I took no damage and he took two, and I thought that was pretty funny to start our game with me not attacking. So the three questions is, does this score me points? Does this deny or pressure my opponent's points? Or if no to those, what can I do to set myself up to do one of those two things with this unit next turn? Those are how you need to think about in your brain, not just putting out suppression, not just taking off models, although sometimes those things can fall under these other three categories, but you got to think about the clock, you got to think about the objectives, and you got to think about how to link those lines of thoughts together.
See, my first round opponent claimed the victory for the match, but he didn't score any victory points because he didn't do any of the objectives. He just killed me. In my second match, I tried my best to get more victory points, but because I murdered my opponent kind of quickly, in part due to dice, I couldn't make it to the third objective point, which would have scored me that one extra. The victory conditions, for whatever they may be, they're worth the points to take a look at.
Yeah, because like I said, I lost the singles event by one objective point across all three of my matches. So they're super important.
Yeah, that was really what hamstrung me a lot in my games, was that I couldn't influence the objective factor as often as my opponents could.
So Will, tell us about the power of the red dice.
The Stormtroopers' main thing that sets them apart is that red defense die. The Rebels have their defense surge, but the red defense die without the surge is still way better, I think by one facing on a D6, which is huge. And sometimes if you get lucky, those guys will just stand there and just not die, which is helpful when you can't bring as many bodies as the Rebels can, especially in these low point formats. However, you do not have that on your vehicles or your bikes, so those units do need to be a little more careful with their engagements.
Speaking of that power of the red defense dice, the vehicles don't take suppression. They instead have a mechanical failure. When you get over a certain number of wound value, you roll a dice and look at the vehicle crits, basically. And vehicle damage is kind of spicy. It does some interesting things. So after a vehicle receives wounds that are greater than its resistance, the player that controls it rolls a red defense die. If you get a block, receives a damage token, it basically loses its action during its activation. It's really kind of gross. You get a blank, the miniature's immobilized. It can't move unless it spends two actions to make a move. It also can't move backwards. So if your AT-RT gets immobilized, he's not dancing anymore. He's just hoping to shoot things before he dies. Worse, if you get a critical result on that, you take a weapon destroyed token and you place it on one of the weapons they have. I got this against my poor airspeeder buddy, and he only had one weapon because the thing is so expensive, he couldn't afford another one. So now there's an airspeeder just zooming around the map, not doing any damage because that's all it can do.
Oh, that's awful.
Oh, it was awful. I felt really bad for him. I mean, who expects to roll a crit like that? But I did.
Right.
And so, yeah, just free points zooming around the board. So vehicle damage was really important to see because I only played the ATRT. And I'll be honest with you. He mostly died before I got to a damaged vehicle point. If you're looking to stop an AST, that vehicle damage is going to be really handy.
Well, you have to get to 8 out of 11 before you deal that.
Oh, it is hard.
I had to deal with a lot of crits because between my solo game where I had 2 ATRTs and my team game where we had 4 on our list, we got to roll those red defense dice to damage our vehicles a lot. And they are huge factors. You know, I can't tell you how many times, I think on 3 different occasions, I had an ATRT trying to charge into battle to flame, which is the best attack in the game presently, to flame a group of troopers in cover. And right before he gets there, he gets a damaged, the immobilized to where he can't move. And it's just the worst because now you've got this big dopey thing sitting just outside of range where you have to literally walk up and pray they forget about you for a turn for you to be able to flame on. Those crits are nasty, nasty, nasty. And you've got to be mindful with how you position your vehicles to say, if I roll this particular crit, am I just SOL? And the answer is probably yes. The biggest debate we had in our car ride home, probably, for our takeaway of Legion is something that I think is a really important discussion. And that is, when do you aim and when do you dodge? Everything has these actions available to them, whether they're vehicles or troopers or heroes or whatever, is aim versus dodge. But I think there's no right answer and there's no wrong answer. I think there's a lot of small situational answers that you need to break down on when you consider to aim and when you consider to dodge. When you're thinking about this from the Imperial point of view, aim is superior because almost all of your units, especially your infantrymen, get precise, meaning they get to reroll extra dice. Normally, you spend an aim token, get to reroll 2 things. Stormies get to reroll 3. And the other interesting thing about aim tokens is if you can have multiple of them, you can reroll 2 dice per. And basically what that means is I had a couple opponents get multiple aim tokens to where they could reroll dice, they roll into blanks again, but then they spend a separate aim token, a different aim token, to reroll that blank die a second time and try to turn it to a hit. Obviously, on the other side, rebels love dodge because they have nimble, which means they spend their dodge token and they get it back, meaning they become pretty much unkillable in light cover because you shoot at them, they spend their dodge, they get a suppression token, they get their dodge token back, you shoot them again, they are now technically in heavy cover, cover 2, plus a dodge, and when you're rolling those white stormtrooper dice, you're not going to see 3 hits very often, and the rebel troopers just wipe all 3 of them away and laugh at you. So there's a couple things you need to consider. First is you need to consider timing. Is it safe to aim? Aim is really, really good if everything within range of you or everything that can get within range of you of one action has already activated. And then it's pretty safe to aim. The times you want to dodge is, can I dodge before people shoot? If you're activating with a unit really early, you probably want to dodge. And you can really divide this into thinking like halfway through the turn, you should start aiming. At the first half of the turn, you should start dodging as your second action if you're not having to double move to like grab objectives or, you know, move and shoot. The other thing you need to think about is what type of unit you're moving. Commanders need, at least in the base game with Luke and Vader, they need dodge tokens and they need dodge tokens early. The scariest Vader that I fought all weekend was a guy who had force reflex and he would move once, throw his lightsaber, take the force reflex action, and then take the dodge action. And it was double dodge Vader. And you're just like, why do I ever shoot this thing? It's never going to do anything. Because normally you'd take one shot with something small just to clear that dodge token away. And maybe if the reflect happens, it doesn't just murder you. Double dodge Vader is absolutely terrifying. The other thing you need to think about with aim versus dodge is impact. Vehicles with the armor keyword are incredible with dodge tokens. And I think Ben is going to talk about that here in just a second. It's really, really important to be able to get those dodge tokens when you're facing impact type damage on armor. It sounds kind of counterintuitive because your stuff with armor, you want to hit like trucks, but if you start taking dodge tokens on them, you will stay alive for forever. The other time you should always, 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 always dodge is if you're on an objective. Because once again, this is an objective-based game. We talked about that already. Just keeping an extra body on alive while your commander is touching that objective or carrying that objective or doing whatever can mean the difference between victory and defeat, even if it means you're not taking opponents' models off the board.
So with my small trooper squad, something I noticed is that those white dice at range are really bad. They only have 2 sides with damage on them. Granted, you get 3 with their attack surge, but if you are within range with your stormtroopers to engage a rebel trooper unit in melee, I would say to almost always do it. They get to roll the improved black dice, and they still have their precise ability when they aim in melee. So you can reroll three black dice instead of three white dice, and it'll also tie up that rebel squad in a combat where you're rolling the same attack dice, but they just have worse defense. And in my round three game, I did this with four stormtroopers charged into a group of six rebel troopers, and they came out victorious. So I would definitely recommend using your stormtroopers in melee, as well as using Vader in melee, obviously.
In addition to tying up a group with melee, it means that the opponent can't shoot into that group to kill you. So you can tie down units so they can't shoot outwards. If you know they're going to shoot at your Vader, then throw some stormtroopers in front of them, get into melee, and now you've locked down a firing group.
Yep, which means they won't be handing out any suppression tokens or anything like that.
It's a powerful, powerful thing.
It is.
Speaking of groups that are, you know, you can do things with that may be counterintuitive. Since it is an objective game, one of the objectives we played was you had to go, you gained an action to pick up an objective token. And you basically got points at the end of the game as long as you held it, as long as the unit commander was still holding onto it. So my opponent grabbed one token and just made a run for it. So my troopers lit out after him, tried to fire and suppress him down. And because of the conditions, we were near a lot of terrain. And so he's standing next to a wall that I can't shoot around. It's way too tall. It blocks line of sight. He's down to one trooper. It's the guy with the objective. And he says, you know what? I'm just going to climb. And so don't be afraid to climb terrain. It takes two actions to climb over without any damage. He didn't have it because he was suppressed. And so he's like, you know what? I'm just going to clamber. You roll the defense die. If you get the shield, then you take damage. It's a 1 in 6 chance. But it threw him over the wall, and it forced me to spend two more turns trying to get around to him so I could shoot him. And so he was attempting to run. I actually had to pincer around these two wall units. If I couldn't get there in time, if something tied me up, if something failed, climbing can be a really good way to get behind terrain and save your objective tokens. Plus, you can climb with an ATRT. I took my ATRT to the wall. I thought real hard about climbing. It does have the expert climb ability, but he had a speeder bike coming my way, and I decided to sit there and just shoot when it came around the corner, which I did, of course. It was delightful.
You guys can talk to me about ATRTs all day. They're kind of the best. Listeners, you guys have not lived until you've run up to a 6-man stormtrooper squad in cover and aimed and flamed and got 11 hits, and then they fail all their defense rolls, and you wipe out a full health unit. It's amazing. The cleansing holy fire of the ATRT, you cannot underestimate. But I digress.
I played an ATRT that had flames because it came from FFG that way, and I did that to a unit, and it was actually really nice. I'm just going to be honest with you. It was quite nice.
One of my more satisfying moments was using my ATST to one-shot one of your ATRTs. Not yours specifically, but one of my opponents. It was glorious.
Yeah. They're great for picking off bikes because they ignore that cover. Bikes tend to get in close with their compulsory move, and they just throw dice and things die. But I digress. Big thing that I learned in my second game was the power of the refresh action. I had a squad with an ion trooper that was hunkered down in cover with four suppression tokens thanks to whatever, gosh, it's the stupid Darth Vader card, Master of Evil, that throws out all the suppression, and it's awful, and it makes you want to cry. And I'd already spent my ion shooting at some speeder bikes, and I needed to get everything up and going. Do not be afraid of the power, especially late in the round, of the refresh action. It gets all of your abilities up and ready, no matter how many you have exhausted, and it clears all suppression. I'm going to talk about this a little bit more when I talk about how to build a 500-point rebel list, but the refresh action is a key component for Luke Skywalker. The way that I think you should build Luke, you should be taking that refresh action every turn to keep him clear of suppression, to keep him clear of having to flee the battlefield, and to keep his abilities up and going. But even less than turning on hero abilities or even like reloading the ion gun, even on some troopers that don't have that, if you're one of the last activations in the round and you don't have a great target to shoot and you've got two or three suppression on you, just go ahead, take that refresh action, clear it all off, and be ready to go for the next round. Refresh is, you know, when I first read the rules, I thought, oh, this is the action you take if you've got nothing else to do. But it turns out that it is an incredibly powerful action that can really change the tide of battles. When your opponent thinks they've got a unit on lockdown that they don't have to worry about moving for a while, you just clear that off and you say, next turn, I'm going to run like hell, or I'm going to aim and shoot, or whatever needs to be done. I'm going to pick up this objective. The refresh action changes the landscape of the battlefield going into the next turn in a really cool and dynamic way.
One thing that I also had clarified during the event was that, well, was the order of operations when you're modifying dice. And I know going in, I was a little unclear about it, especially when I found out that impact works a little differently than I think all three of us assumed it did.
Right.
Basically, if you're shooting at it at a unit with the armor keyword and your weapon has impact, it says to rotate your X number of hits to crits. But before that happens, the opponent can actually cancel those hit results with cover or dodges or stuff like that, which I know in my first round game, I did not do correctly. I was just instantly saying, oh, well, I have impact, and turning them so that way they wouldn't get canceled. But it does turn out that the opponent that you're shooting at does get to cancel the hits before you turn them into crits with impact.
Yeah, and that's why taking that dodge on a vehicle can be super important and extend their life exponentially. Because I know a lot of times, especially against the stormtroopers with the rocket launchers that have impact 3, you can just deny their ability to flip all three dice, because it's very rare that they throw enough hits to let you cancel one or two of them and still have enough to flip over. And it'll make your ATRTs and your speeders live a whole lot longer.
One of the things I discovered was the playing of the command cards and when to do what with what. Since you tend to use your commander's specific cards, like your Luke card if you're playing the Rebels, to do these things, Luke has a fantastic one-pip card, allows you to get in there, attack, and then attack again.
I hate that card.
It's the best.
Oh, it's beautiful. In my very first game, I'm set up to go do a double attack on two different Stormtrooper bike units. He's down to one unit apiece, and he is actually close enough that I can leap, be in melee contact with both of them, and then, of course, kill one, and then turn around and kill the other. So I play this one-pip card.
Oh, that's bad news.
Oh, it was going to be beautiful. Except my opponent, seeing this as well, plays his one pip card from Vader. And of course, at that point, there's a roll-off. The person in command of the turn dial rolls a red die. And on shields, the red defense die. And on shields, you get it. You win. You get to go first. If you don't, though, your opponent gets to go first. And I lost the die roll. So then I'm forced with, well, I've got this Luke who can do this thing. How far away am I? And so I got lucky. I was close enough to go swing at Vader, where I promptly blanked out. But I at least got to make the attempt at it. But I realized that I had put myself in a place that I didn't have a backup option if I didn't get the first pip card. And so it's one of those, when looking at your pip, which order you want to go in, make sure you've got some backup plans in case you don't get the first activation, which I assumed I was going to get. He'd already played his ambush. I thought, oh yeah, he's not going to play his one Vader card here. And nope, didn't get it. So my backup plan, I got lucky. It worked out for me. Sort of, but it was definitely something that I had to rethink about.
Yeah, and kind of piggybacking off of that, you always have to pay attention to your opponent's discard pile about every turn, because you've got so much to think about, especially in the team games. You've got a lot to think about on what cards you need to play. But before every turn, before I picked every card, I asked to see my opponent's discard pile of the cards they had played. Not so much for their abilities, but just to make sure that I knew what pips had been played and if I'm safe to drop my one or I'm safe to drop my two and be able to get priority.
So with that being said, because pip command cards can differ, and of course, depends on your commanders. So we played, Will, Ryan, and I both played the first round, or the first three games, with just one commander. And so I only had the commander cards for Luke. Will had only the command cards for Vader. And I kind of wonder, since Ryan, you got to play a team game where you got to play with, two commanders, and you saw the Imperial commander, you saw Veers and Vader across the table.
Yeah.
How'd that command deck change? How did that change the things that you were doing?
So getting to play the team event with Leia and Veers, I was really fortunate that I got to play all three of my matches, or really all six of my matches on the day were Rebels versus Imperials. And really, Veers in the format that we played had a huge advantage in that regard. They didn't give us everything to play with. We had no upgrades on Leia and Veers, and they only gave us one of their three command cards. And the big advantage, because I think as a lone model, I think Leia's a little stronger than Veers, so they gave Veers a better command card. Leia got a pip 2 command card, and Veers got another pip 1. So that means we were playing with 8 command cards in hand, the 6 that we've been playing with, and then plus the extra one for the new model. And Veers and Vader getting an extra one pip, meaning that 3 out of the 6 times that we played, and none of my games went past the 4th or 5th round, they got to go first, and they got to go first really, really liberally. But luckily, the one card we got from Leia really helped to mitigate that. Veers got to shoot with his AT-ST and pick someone at least range 4 away from him, roll 4 black dice at them with impact 2 and immune to deflect. And he would just get to wreck some stuff at initiative 1, while Leia at pip 2 could order 2 troopers. And when they ordered them, they would get a speed 1 move, really helping you like, okay, my opponent's going to go first, but now I'm going to sneak back into cover, or I'm going to run for this objective, or get someplace where the thing that they wanted to do couldn't happen. So yeah, Leia and Veers really helped change that initiative battle quite a bit in very different and unique ways.
So just seeing the one card from Leia, and of course you're a Rebels fan, so let's take that with our grain of salt here when you talk about her. And we had this conversation on the ride to Adepticon and from the ride back. Do you ditch Luke when Leia becomes available? Or do you go ahead and run both commanders?
That's tough. It's an interesting conversation to have. Luke's expensive, and the Rebels really want a lot of bodies on the field because they don't have that, like Will talked about, they don't have that red die. They only save versus damage on a 2 versus 6 of almost all their units. Leia's a pretty darn good model, but she's not the combat powerhouse that Luke is, and she's not the hard counter to Vader that Luke is. I think Leia brings some really different tools to the Rebel toolkit. The way I like to play the game, I'm probably going to try to ditch Luke when she comes out and just run single Leia. Basically, you get 2 extra trooper squads to fill the gap where Luke was, because she's that much cheaper. Luke is a damage powerhouse, and he gets to lead from the front while Leia gets to lead from the back. They feel really different. They feel really unique. But I also like the idea is if you bring both commanders, you get to have special abilities on all 6 of your non-standing orders command cards. And that can be really, really powerful because not only are you paying the points for a commander on their stat line and have their unit on the field, but you're paying for their ability to bring those command cards into your hand. And that's not something to be overlooked.
What were your impressions of Veers from a Rebel perspective?
Man, Veers is annoying. Just on the table, Leia is flat out better than Veers. Her gun is better. Her abilities tend to be a little bit better. But the way that Veers synergizes with the Imperial forces is terrifying. I played against only 1 AT-ST list, and we had some ion guns that were managed to peg that thing down. And we're like, oh, we're going to really mitigate its damage by only giving it 1 action and slowly pick away at it. But Veers' ability to just stand there, activate first, and throw a couple aim tokens out before he pressured the side of the map that he was on was really terrifying. And his little dinky white triple white die gun with impact was pretty scary. It did some damage to my ATRTs, and he was no real slouch. He gets the red defense die while Leia just gets the white. Veers, like, they're kind of cool mirrors to each other. And obviously his ability to bring that extra 1 pip command card that doesn't attack is really, really powerful. Veers is scary. He doesn't help shore up the Empire's weaknesses, but it really helps him push forward on their advantages.
So will the Imperial unit, will they drop Vader for the amount of points? Because we're having a hard time with a 500-point list making enough space because Vader is our commander. And he's good at what he does. He is Lord Vader.
I think if you want to bring the AT-ST, I think you're going to drop Vader for it. I think we're going to start to see you take Veers and an AT-ST, or you're going to take Vader. I don't know how much sense there is once we have, you know, Vader and Veers and Snowtroopers, how much value there's going to be into taking both. Because Veers letting that AT-ST double aim, because it rolls all of its attack dice at once and just getting to reroll all of them and do just immense amounts of damage, means you just basically get to roll up, sit back, and pepper your opponent from far. But Vader is that guy that kind of can get up and mess with those frontline engagements and really hold down a command point. I think when Snowtroopers come out, I think you're going to start to see, oddly enough, Veers with a lot of the Wave 1 upgrades with bikes and AT-STs and Stormtroopers. And then you're actually going to see Vader and Snowtroopers a lot together. And I think once we get that wave, the Imperials will really start to feel quite fleshed out with a bunch of different options. But I think it's kind of funny how I think Veers is going to pair better with the older stuff and Vader's going to pair better with the newer stuff.
How'd the 6x3 map, how did that change the way you're doing commanders? Because I imagine if you have 2 commanders, you're guaranteed to be able to order the things that you want to order. But if you just have 1 on that big map, are you going to have to take a comm unit or?
Yeah, I think it makes long-range comms, you know, a lot more viable. I don't think you really bother taking long-range comms if you're going to run the double commander list. You know, I had my round 3 opponent in the team game really pushed hard on one side of the map to the point to where the map was kind of divided into thirds for objective tokens. And at one point towards the end of the game, both Vader and Veers were only on the left side of the board. And it really kind of threw them for a loop because their right side was so unorganized and they didn't know when things were going to be able to activate and if they would flee. But the ability to spread out that command, I think if you are running single commander, long range comms becomes worth its weight in gold. If not, it's kind of okay at best. You'll probably only put it on bikes or a or the T-47 Snowspeeder, those things with that are really fast and the compulsory moves. But watching how the meta is going to develop around the 1 and 2 commander lists will be super interesting.
Well, speaking of big maps and whether or not you're going to use the comps, let's move our way into our battlefield design. I played on 2 different maps. Adepticon had beautiful map setups. We were briefly introduced to the gentleman who set those up for him, and I apologize, I didn't grab your name before you walked away. He was a super nice guy. I say he's super nice. I wanted to steal every one of them, so I'm going to make that a compliment.
Yep.
They were that good. If I'd had a truck and a couple of guys, and I could distract some people with a smoke bomb, there's a chance I steal all the tables. They look just absolutely beautiful.
I just wanted the TIE Defender.
Oh, that TIE Defender. Oh, is it? We'll talk about that in a second. Is it? Will, what was your favorite map? What did you see on the table that just looked beautiful?
Unfortunately, during my Thursday games, I really only got to play on one map. It was a nice setup. It was themed to be like middle of the woods on Endor with a one Imperial building. The way they did the tree trunks, where they used actual 3.5 inch either saplings or branches in these foam bases that went up probably 2 feet in the air, but that way they didn't really have like a canopy that would really get in the way of moving your models and stuff, but still gave the feeling of being in that indoor forest. But my favorite of the weekend was definitely FFG's setup. Over in their booth, they had a 6x3 map of the Battle of Hoth they were using for larger demo games, and it was beautiful. It had a full rebel hangar on one end that the airspeeders could fly out of. It had trenches with troopers in it all over the place. Leia, Veers, Vader, and Luke all over the place. It was a beautiful setup. And I think, did we put any pictures up of it, Ben?
I did. A picture of Alex Davey in front of that map.
Okay, nice. I just wanted to make sure. Be sure to check those out on our Instagram and Facebook. It was beautiful.
So my favorite play map was there was this really cool Tatooine setup that we got to play round 3 of the team game against some guys from Canada. It was a super close game, super fun, but the fun thing about it was the 2 deployment zones for the mission we were playing had very, very, very different feels. And we both got the side, because we were running very different lists, we both got the side that I think we kind of wanted. They got an open flank on one end and a dense kind of building cluster on another, where they could put on the open end their bikes, and we could kind of spread our forces to get a little bit of cover to really take advantage of the rebels' ability to be nimble. It was kind of a perfect storm that made it a really cool map, because our lists paired off really well against each other of trying to do very, very different things. The map itself was kind of split into 3 distinct areas. The right side was smattered with some light cover from some moisture evaporators and like one building to kind of block off a main corridor for bikes to come swooping through. The center, kind of at about range 2 from each of our board edge, there were a couple of buildings and like a sled that provided light and heavy cover. And on the right side, there was a tight compound of a handful of buildings. And the objective that we were playing put in each of those zones, each of like right in the middle of them, objective tokens. And at certain points during the game, we got victory points by having the most infantry or trooper unit commanders within those zones. And so it really felt like 3 distinct battlefields, and that taking and controlling each of those zones took very different approaches and gave you very different offensive and defensive capabilities. And so it really did feel like 3 different little pitched battles that all had a unique feel. But the fact that both of us got the start that we wanted and both of us got like really good first engagements, it made the map feel really, really cool and dynamic. And so like, as you guys are getting ready to build your own maps and your own setups, make sure that your whole map isn't just like the urban map or the desert map. Make sure they've got different feels and different vibes like every 9 inches or so, to where you can really get a good varied sense, so everyone, no matter what kind of list they can bring, can find a place on the map to really push their advantage.
See, for me, I got to play a map that Ryan didn't like the first time through. I did play the indoor map, and it was beautifully set up. It had the Battle Kiwi terrain, which if you look at the Instagram, looks fantastic. I played on the other Battle Kiwi map, and they had lots of their terrain as well. And this was what I keep calling the Sullus map or the Mustafar map. And you'll see pictures on the Instagram. On one side, it was like a town square. There were some walls that blocked line of sight, but you had a battlefield in the middle with lots of light cover to get some close melee and close range shooting. The objective tokens really made you want to fight over the center because of the way the objectives were set up in this. Our condition was one that you couldn't quite see the other side of the map when you started, so it forced us to go into the middle, and it was rebel on rebel, and it was just a bloodbath. Troopers were dying left and right from both sides. His loot came in, destroyed something. It was set up very nicely. And then on the other half of that map was like the production facility area. And so it had 2 large walls and lots of light terrain kind of scattered on one side. What Ryan didn't like was that in his game, it was just one wall on the, I'll say, the left-hand side, one large wall on the right-hand side, and then a lot of scattered terrain on one side. And so when the person who set up originally or someone who moved it from the original setup day, one team definitely had an advantage in the light cover area because it was all on one side of the map. When my third round opponent and I looked at the map, we were like, there's way too much on this side. So we kind of removed everything, kind of set up a little bit more balance so we both had access to things. It was a slightly different place. And he and I had a blast on that map. The harsh environment condition made it very difficult for us to push units out. It basically said you can't remove suppression tokens at the end of the turn unless your unit commander is touching a piece of terrain. So with objective tokens out in the middle of the field and these two walls that we were fighting between, you really couldn't get stuck out there because if you got suppressed, you weren't removing it. Rally dice, they worked for Ryan. They did not work for me the entire day. It was beautifully cinematic. It gave a place for the bikes to run down the middle or to hide around a corner. It gave us walls to climb over and places to hide and the terrible, terrible weather that I assume exists on Mustafar. Super cinematic, super fun, but did require us tweaking it a little bit to make it exactly what we wanted. But we were super happy with it. So there are photos on the Instagram. Take a look at it. When you're designing your own, I've got to echo Ryan. Make sure it's diverse. Make sure not the entire map looks exactly the same, or you don't have one side that's just a wide open, you know, battlefield and all the heavy blocking line of sights on one side, or the map is nothing but line of sight blocking, because then you just end up kind of either walking around or climbing walls half the time. There was a beautiful camp set up for a TIE fighter and a defender, and those guys were in scale and they were massive and they loomed over the field and it looked beautiful, but it was filled with nothing but line of sight blocking walls. And so it channeled every battle I saw there into this alleyway that just became death. You didn't have enough activations to kind of really wrap around the map, especially with Vader. Bikes had a hard time getting around because of their ability. They can go over, you know, I guess height one, which is about, you know, 6 inches. But anything bigger than that, they really couldn't do. So it caused some difficulties for the bikers. And so a nice balanced map really, really will do some beautiful things. Make it cinematic, make it also fun.
Yeah, kind of speaking about how to make it cinematic, how to make it fun, one of the last things we want to do on tonight's show is we want to give you guys some advice, some help on building the best 500-point list you can. I know the three local kickoff events that we're going to be hitting in the next couple of weeks are all running variations of the 500-point rule set that we got to play at Adepticon because they were really well thought out and they were really great stepping stones to get us to that 800-point game. And honestly, it's really refreshing knowing that by Saturday, I only have to have 500 points worth of units painted and not the full 8. So we want to give you guys a couple of tips, tricks, and our thoughts on 2 imperialists, 2 rebel lists to bring and some other things to consider when you're thinking about bringing that heavy, whether it be the T-47 or the AT-ST. For the rebels, you really only have 2 options. But before I talk about what those 2 options are, I want to talk about, for me, what I kind of consider a non-negotiable. And I want to say this is for the 500-point battle. You could probably change this up a little bit once we get to the bigger point value, and that is Luke. I see really only one way to play and to build Luke, and that is with Jedi Mind Trick, and that is with Force Reflex. Force Reflex is pretty much a staple to any Force-wielding commander that we have right now. Maybe that'll change in the future, but I really doubt it. And that is, you know, Luke with 2 things that give him free actions that he has to refresh in order to get back. But with Luke's charge ability, your action is either going to be move and then use your free actions and then refresh them, or if you're already engaged in melee, attack and then refresh and use your abilities. The other cool thing that really makes us really synergize well with Luke is his leap ability. The fact that almost any terrain you're going to be playing with on these small 3x3s, Luke is just able to vault over and ignore. I can't tell you how many walls I leapt over all day and go and stabby stab. Leaping over walls to where my opponent just physically couldn't see or attack or hurt Luke, waiting till later in the round, being able to just vault over a building or a barricade or whatever and get into base-to-base contact, throw a bunch of suppression down, and then swing away and grab my dodge token. It makes Luke really, really hard to kill and a huge threat. So it's pop 2 suppression down on somebody who's going to hurt Luke or going to hurt your trooper squad that Luke's trying to protect. Get him that dodge token, get him that dodge token early, and tie somebody up in melee with a move or with leap. So those are the non-negotiables. Build your Luke that way from our rebel players. On the 3x3 mat, guys, you want to bring an AT-RT with a flamer. You guys cannot hear me preach enough on the glory that is the aim and flame of the AT-RT, wiping out entire squads, murdering speeder bikes. If it's a full speeder bike unit and an AT-RT gets with the range of his flamethrower, with the combination of the blast keyword and the speeder bike's cover and the way that the black dice versus the white defense dice with the bikes work out, you're almost guaranteed to get a bike every time you shoot. It feels really good, and it's a great way to control both the bikes and obviously the stormtrooper squads, because it gives you two black dice per model in the group that you're targeting at range one. And getting into range one on these 3x3 maps with 500 points is pretty doggone easy. You're going to want to get in there, aim and flame, man. And the ATRT is pretty quick, so we can close that distance. Your two options for list building are, do you want to build two troopers and two ATRTs, or three troopers and one ATRT? For my run, I managed to go with two ATRTs and two troopers. The advantage of that build is you get a lot of firepower. In the solo event, in the three games I played for solo, all of my games did not go to the end of round six because everyone was dead. Everyone was dead by round four or five. The ATRTs did so much damage. Luke's command card, Son of Skywalker, did so much damage that you could just rout an enemy pretty quickly, even with the Stormtroopers' red defense dice.
The FFG list gave us was filled with three Rebel Troopers and an ATRT. I felt like I always had more activations. I had more bodies. I had the full troop unit. I had all six of the figures out, you know, a specialty unit plus the extra trooper. And I always felt better prepared than my Imperial opponent just because I had more stuff on the board.
Yeah. And that's the other list is in both of these lists, whether you take two troopers and two ATRTs or three troopers and one, your troopers can pretty much be outfitted with the extra body and the heavy weapon any way you want to. The trade-off, if you choose to bring three troopers, is you lose a little bit of firepower from those flamethrowers, which really do good work against the course unit things that we get for the Imperials. But you get more objective control. You get technically the same number of activations, but a lot of the scenarios require trooper leaders to do things. And trooper leaders are great for holding down big swaths of area. And it's going to let you be able to control the battlefield a little bit better having that extra trooper. So when you're building your list for your 500 points, you have to decide, do you want the firepower of the double ATRT double trooper, or do you want the control that the triple trooper single ATRT list gives you? But once again, I think the Luke with Mind Trick and Reflex is kind of a non-negotiable.
I'm going to echo Chase from Nashville right here. Ryan likes to blow things up. Chase is going to ask the question, does that get you the objective victory point?
No, that's absolutely true. That's absolutely true.
Shout out to Chase.
But I did win more games than you, Ben. I did win more.
Just one. I only played three. So, Will, what's the Imperial list look like? What's that look like here?
For those Imperial players out there, this 500-point format is a little rough on us. The Rebel players get a lot more flexibility and options in this format because for Vader to be worth what you're putting in, you got to pay 225 points. Like Luke, there's really one build, or if you have extra points, you could throw maybe a choke onto this. But I say you bring Darth Vader with reflexes and saber throw. If you have to cut one, cut something else in your list, because otherwise your Vader will not do what you need him to do to be worth it.
The Vaders without saber throw, I was never that afraid of. I could run from them.
Yep.
He's slow enough that I could have a troop who picked up an objective token, just book it, because they were faster.
Oh, yeah. Vader needs throw, otherwise he just hobbles around and says, come back here, like an old man with his cane. Once you have that Vader, kind of like with Rebels, there's a couple options available, and neither of them should involve the AT-SD, unless you have it painted, in which case, bring it because cool factor. You won't do well, but you will impress everyone at your event. But from my perspective, there's bringing three troopers, with two of them having DLT-19s, and the third only having impact grenades, and then a group of bikes with no upgrades. Basically, so your three trooper squads will have some access to impact, your bikes have impact, and Vader will have enough upgrades that he can be intimidating to your opponent with his free dodge, reflecting, and the three dice with impact three. It can really wreck your opponent's plans. If you are a big fan of bikes, you could also bring Vader two trooper units and two groups of bikes, but that does really limit your points. Not as heavily as the AT-ST list does, but I think you can't bring specialist troopers when you do that. You might be able to bring the extra bodies, but not the heavy weapons. What I recommend is Darth Vader with the two upgrades, the three groups of troopers, and one group of bikes. I think that's going to do the best in this format.
I will say about the double bike list, the double bike list is probably one of the strongest across both factions alpha strikes you can get in the 500-point game. nothing in the 500 point game, I think even if you include the T-47 and the AT-ST, can hit quite as fast and hard as double bikes. If you can get a good shot off on that small map where you just take that compulsory move, aim and shoot, you can put a lot of pressure on your opponent turn one, and that's not to be overlooked.
Two bikes, throw two red, two black, and two white dice.
With impact two.
With impact two, yeah. Plus the aim token. I mean, you shoot something with it and you shoot early, it's going to be rough for your opponent.
But you have to remember, those bikes don't pick up objectives, and that's the name of the game.
You're absolutely right. They are really good at the... Sometimes they can score objectives. With the compulsory move, you can loop around, because only of the missions we played, only one of them had the requirement for trooper leaders to interact with the objective. But I think depending on your particular play style, I think double bikes can work. But you do have to know the pros and cons going into it.
I think it forces your stormtroopers to be more defensive, because you need them to interact with the objective tokens or with the victory condition.
Right. That makes total sense.
And maybe at that point, the extra bodies are worth it, just so you have more substance. You won't get wiped out as easily.
More stopping power. So, you know, going back to the T-47 and the AT-ST, I think there are two reasons not to bring them. And I think there's one big reason to bring it that Will kind of already touched on. The two big reasons not to bring the AT-ST or the T-47 is, in this point format, they're a huge point sink. Will had been playing, he probably played the most demo games out of us leading up to Adepticon. So when he got there, it made total sense that he wanted to play the AT-ST, because it was something new, it was something fresh. But it was a huge point sink to where the rest of his army really suffered for it.
Without the extra weapons, the AT-ST really isn't worth it.
The other thing you have to consider with the AT-ST, or really the T-47, and this applies to both of them, is their ability to interact with objectives. I think the T-47 can interact with a couple of the objectives a little bit better, but it's still really, really tough. So with them taking up so much of your army and still having a really hard time completing objectives, I think those are two big reasons to try to stay away from them. But Ben, why should you take the T-47 and the AT-ST?
Because if it's beautiful, it is so cool looking on that table. The T-47 came running at my troops and I was terrified. It was going to do terrible, terrible things to me. I got very lucky that I managed to hit it first with some ion, which limited some movement. So all I could do was move and then shoot me. But it wiped out a squad of troopers. It was rough. It was something that was going to do terrible things to me. But it looks beautiful. It comes swooping across the board. It's going to loop around. It's going to shoot you in the back. The AT-ST towers over this map. I'm an Imperial Assault player, and I have one, and it sits up bigger with those things, but this thing is just majestic. I've seen poses on the internet that it looks like a dancing AT-ST. I'm kind of want to try. I mean, it just looks great on the table. It really does. And people are going to come to your map and be like, man, that's awesome.
Yeah, I had people coming up taking pictures of the painted one all day. It towered over everything, and on the map with those trees kind of emerging between tree trunks with its, you know, massive guns going off, it was impressive to see.
Yeah, so if you're a fan of those models and the game is going to be more fun for you to play with them, then do it. If it's not, if you're just thinking about kind of throwing it in there, then you should probably stay away from it. But if it's what you want to do, then totally do it. It's a game about tiny plastic men shooting imaginary space guns. So you should have fun with it.
It's super fun. Make all the laser noises you want to. The crack a James Air jokes. You can just say the number 1111 all over and over again. Sounds just like those lasers.
So the last thing we really want to touch on from Adepticon was that on Friday, they did reveal to us some new units for the Rebellion. They showed off.
Yay!
Yes, nothing from my empire, though. Sadness. They showed us Han Solo as a commander, and our first special forces unit, the Rebel Scouts. Han Solo, there's an article out for both of these units. It really doesn't tell you much except that they exist.
Oh.
Like, honestly, it's like, he can do a thing, sort of, bye, and then that's all.
But for those people who like to zoom, you can zoom in on that picture and you can see everything that it does.
Or you can retweet or share us on Facebook and maybe get us to mail you that cool Han Solo card where you can see it in ultra high def with your own face.
And it's such a beautiful card.
It is a movie still, Han Solo.
No, I don't think it's a movie still.
Is it not?
No, it's rendered.
Okay.
It's well-painted art, and it matches up with the Leia Veers promo card that they released as well.
But the one thing we want to talk about Han Solo, like, we can go into all the things that he could or could not do. We can talk about his zero pip card. That's all neat. That's all fine. He rolls a red defense die that surges and gets three defensive rerolls. That's insane. I don't know how to kill him, and I'm really happy that I chose to be a rebel player.
Yeah, I'm worried.
And he surges for defense.
So for those of you more used to number values, that is essentially on a D6, you need a 3+, and you reroll ones and twos.
Yeah, you get 3 rerolls every time he defends. And when a stormtrooper only, you know, throws all those white dice and might get 2 or 3 hits, that pretty much means he's never going to take damage from anything other than a big vehicle or Darth Vader.
Yeah.
Now, I can hear you internet folk out there, but wait, the card on FFG has a white dice. We were told by the man that it's actually a red dice, that the article is a misprint.
Yeah, so the alt art that we got and that we're giving away has the red die printed on it. See, he's going to be an insane unit. Now, there are some thoughts out there that there's the version that we see on the website is the Special Forces version, to where you'll be able to take Han as a commander or as a Special Forces unit. I can't confirm or deny that. I don't know what's going on, but that would be a really fun twist if we got 2 different versions and he could fit in 2 different spots in your army.
I hadn't heard about that.
Yeah, I'd heard some rumors about that. The other thing that's kind of neat is we get kind of that same idea in the Rebel Commandos article, to where we get 2 unit cards for the Rebel Commandos where you can take all 5 of them, or you can just take 2 with heavy weapons that they kind of don't tell us what they are. We know that there's a bomb that they can drop, and we know that one's a sniper rifle with unlimited range. So having looked at the stat card just a little bit, you're just going to have to answer, Will, hypothetically, you only get to take 1. Do you take the 5 or do you take the 2, Ben?
Ooh, I like Loku. I'm always about a Mon Calamari Special Forces unit. I like the idea of the 2. I think point cost is much, much cheaper. And it allows you to go set up on those places on the map. Terrain, depending on what you're playing. I played one that would have been a fantastic place for a sniper. Who's just going to sit at the top and going to shoot down. He's going to dodge out. He's got surges for both offense and defense. I think I take the 2-person team.
Will?
I think I'm with Ben. I think that 2-person team sounds like a great distraction unit for not very many points, especially with that they get some sort of redeploy ability where after you deploy them, they get to do a free move before anything else happens. So you kind of get to move them forward a little bit in case some of their weapons have cumbersome. You could get them into a favorable position before the game even starts fully.
So I'm going to be the odd man out, and I say you take the 5. And you take the 5 for one reason and one reason only. Obviously, you get the scout too, so you can start them out there. You get 5 models that have low profile. Every one of them has low profile for their cost, meaning that they improve their cover by 1. And also, you get 5 models with sharpshooter 1, meaning that when you're shooting at somebody, you reduce their cover by 1. And having a whole squad instead of just 2 units that are all able to mitigate that and to increase their own, I think is going to be super, super, super clutch.
But the thing reads, if you have light covers, you already have to be behind the cover.
Still, come on, you're a commander. You should be doing that anyway.
You're not wrong. You're not wrong. And they do throw a black die, so that's 5 black dice. If your troops are all together, they surge offensive and defensively, reducing their cover. I mean, it's like getting rid of a dodge token. It's nice.
Yeah, getting these guys into light cover with a dodge token and then just letting them kind of stay in an objective zone is going to be pretty great, especially when they surge on both. So that's a 2 and 6 on a white die save after you've already removed 3 pieces of cover or 3 hits from your dodge token and your cover. Sadly, the nimble keyword's not there, but somehow I'll mend my broken heart.
Now, Will, these are dirty, dirty terrorist units, according to the Empire. And we really can't tell what it is, but they get something very special that so far, brand new to this game, they get some kind of bomb token.
Mm-hmm.
It looks like they're going to set off some ordnance when they get further away, when you have to walk near it. So
hopefully they will provide us with sufficient units to counter these insurgents.
Or not. It's cool.
No, it's not.
I will say, I was one of those people, I wanted more aliens in my Rebels, and so I do like the idea we get a Mon Calamari. I am told that the unit leader is possibly someone named Pruneface. as a Trek man, I don't know who that is, but apparently Lucas made a toy of it, so it exists in canon, or did.
Yeah, we get a whole bunch of aliens, and I'm pretty excited. Well, I think that about wraps up our super extra long episode 1. Now that it's not just episode 0, we got to play the game. We got to talk about some terrain. We got to go to an awesome convention. I want to thank the Adepticon staff. I want to thank the FFG staff for all the awesome, awesome, awesome weekend. I want to thank all my opponents, even those whose names I forgot. Like, you guys were awesome. I didn't have a single bad game across all 4 days. It was just so, so, so much fun. We're hoping to keep doing this. We're hoping to do an episode every other week-ish. We've got the next 3 weeks, if you're in the East Tennessee area, we've got release kits in Nashville, the Tri-Cities in Northeast Tennessee, and then here, our home store in Knoxville. If you want to come out and play games with us, we'd love to have you. I want to thank our producer, John Michael, who's going to make us sound great and edit out a whole bunch of stuff because he's fantastic. And I want to thank you guys for coming back and listening. Like, we got a way better response from our episode zero than at least I ever thought that we would ever get from just being a bunch of yahoos talking about a game that isn't even out yet. And so for the STABcast, for the Sun Sphere Tactical Attack Brigade, I'm Ryan Slowoski, and I want to remind you guys to always aim and flame.
This has been Will Heim, and remember, they can't dodge if they're dead.
And Ben Fowler, won't anyone think of the terrain?
Guys, we are signing off. Have a great night.
We'll be right back, folks. And Ryan's dead.